I think one of the things that will help us tremendously is to be able to have data to understand for all centers, right? How are these kids showing up at you know, CMS and kindergarten? Because what it'll help us do is one, to actually see which centers are really doing it well. Because when you know that, then you can also have, Miss Betty's, center be able to go see what high quality looks like. Because we know these kids that come from this center show up really well. They know their capital letters and their lowercase letters. They know what a right side up for a book is. Like, they're ready to learn, right? And so having those data will really help us better be able to understand the entire system and understanding how well it is working. Because part of what we do know is that the only way that you get to the end of third grade, for example, of having 47% of black boys below basic, 46% of Hispanic boys below basic, is a lot of those boys show up in kindergarten and they don't know their name, how to write their name and their letters and their numbers. And so we have to understand this issue in order to solve that issue with third grade. And so this just further underscores that for us, all of this work really begins at birth, right? And so we need the data, right, at these various points that we can better understand where kids are at so we can focus our efforts and energies to improve the systems and outcomes for all kids. We need to make sure that getting children the right teachers, the right educators, is one of the most powerful things we can do to make sure that they are on grade level by the time they finish third grade. And I would add that parents are the first teachers, parents and caregivers, so it begins at birth. And it's making sure that the parent and caregiver are doing the things they need to do, that pre-K, early childhood educators are doing the things they need to do, and that elementary educators are doing the things they need to do. And we need to empower, right, inform, and engage all of them. And then all of us as a community need to wrap arms around that child and around the system and do everything we can to make sure that the system works better. What we're doing right now is really good at producing the levels of outcomes we're getting, 40%. And frankly, this is the highest that we've ever produced, right, over the last 10, 15 years, right? In order for us to move from 40 to 60 to 80, we're gonna have to do different things. And so it's not to say that the work, that we're not having good work anywhere, we are, right? We gotta go, as Jim Collins would say, from good to great. And that means that we've got to change the behavior, change the way that we work together so that we can get better outcomes for more kids in the community. But you're absolutely right. There's one thing you could do is to have really good educators in the lives of kids. But again, just remember, it starts at birth. So the first thing is really about building a common agenda that we all buy into. This can't be something that we do or we try to impose. That doesn't work. This has to be a community-owned agenda. ReCharla has to be us. It cannot be them or they, right? If it's them or they, we fail. The only way that we succeed for kids is for ReCharla to be us, all of us in the community. So it first begins with having a common agenda, right? The common metaphor we use is like we're all rowing in the boat in the same direction. We're all trying to get to the same place, right? The second thing is that we've got to align all of the efforts within each of those four areas. So the first working group, Talk With Me Baby, that's focused on parents and caregivers from birth to four. The second working group that's focused on school readiness, right? Making sure that children have high quality early childhood experiences. The third working group, Schoolhouse, which is focused on K-3, making sure that educators have the resources they need, struggling students get the supports they need, and then the fourth working group focused on summer learning. In each of those areas, we've got to align all of the work that's happening within them, and then we got to align and work on the transitions between them, right? That's really the core of the coordinating work, and providing a forum for all of us to come together. One of the early things that's been interesting is just in a few of the meetings I've been involved in is some of the people saying, like, while there have been groups that have been meeting together, early literacy working group, there's the literacy roundtable, already we've seen a few meetings where folks were coming together that hadn't come together before, and I would say that's exactly the kinds of things that we're looking to do, is to bring folks together, to gather regularly, talking about this issue of early literacy. Thank you. We are absolutely interested and absolutely have to know what works. So we're interested in evaluation. We're very interested in outcomes. What I can tell you from my just two months of conversation, there are lots of groups working really hard trying to answer this question. Many of them are trying to answer it on their own, and many of them are trying to answer the exact same question. And so it's interesting to me that, again, have the same conversation with lots of groups, and they're using different assessments to try to answer the same thing. They are many of them are small, limited capacity to kind of do this kind of work. And so it seems to us that there is a real opportunity to leverage that across all of the groups and to find a way that we can create better efficiencies to answer this question, to help each individual group know whether they're actually making an impact for kids, right? In reading and in the different parts of reading. So we're absolutely, we're interested in that. I think, like we said before, we need to better understand what the issues are. So, you know, we're gonna look before we leave, but this is definitely an area that we're focused on. So absolutely support professional development. So I've had the great privilege in my career to visit some really great schools that are doing really great work for kids. And all of the best professional development I've seen is really routinely organized in the school. It's not the kind where you have teachers go out and go to a session, bring it back. It's not a situation where you have somebody kind of drop in and come out. It's where routinely, day in and day out, like you have people coming into the classroom, observing teachers, giving feedback, coaching them, helping them get better, where they're using data, right? Both grade levels, right, and especially for elementary, and grade levels, and looking at what the data tell them. They're using to differentiate instruction and making sure they're getting the right kind of help to the right kinds of kids. And if you were to take that one step further for what's possible in CMS, not only can we do that, right, for all 108 schools that have either K-3 or pre-K-3 in Charlotte-Mecklenburg schools, but we can also have a better system so that when we have external groups coming in providing support, we're getting the right kid to the right kind of support at the right time.
And that's called culture relevance.
Absolutely. We know, of course, in early childhood education, social-emotional development is incredibly important. It's one of the five domains, right, of that we focus on for early childhood education. When I've talked to superintendents in the past and I've asked them about early childhood education, particularly kindergarten readiness, every single one of them have always put social-emotional development at the top. Because you have a child who shows up that's ready to learn and has a positive attitude about learning, you can do a lot more, right, for that child, right, than for a child that doesn't have that social emotional development. So obviously it's part of the, as we think about school readiness, that's incredibly important. I think also too, it's hard to read Education Week these days without tripping over an article that's talking about the importance of social emotional development. The conversations in the last several years about grit and character development is all about social emotional development. What I will say is that we know that the work that we do at Reach Charlotte and our focus is nested within a lot of other issues. And so while we are focused on, you know, literacy, early literacy, third grade reading, we understand that there are a lot of other things that are involved. Families, we talk about starting at birth, but we know that this actually starts before birth. And we know that there are issues that happen after third grade. We're kind of laser focused on third grade reading, but certainly look to work with others and others partnering that are actually more focused on other pieces, that we can see how our work can all kind of connect together. And again, that we can accomplish more working together. So while there will be some pieces that will address social emotional, I can't jump ahead of the working groups and what comes out of that process. But what I can tell you is, to the extent that we need to make sure that we're addressing adjacent pieces that will help kids read proficiently, we're going to take a look at that entire landscape.